Welcome back to our study in the Gospel of John. We're going to be in John chapter 3 today, looking at the story of Nicodemus. In chapter 1 of John, we looked at Emmanuel, God with us. He became flesh and dwelt among us. In chapter 2, we saw where Jesus performed his first miracle at Cana, and then he cleansed the temple of the money changers. Both of these instances affirm the deity of Christ. This week, we come to the story of Nicodemus, and we see what it takes for a person to come to God. The story of Nicodemus is one of the best known passages in the New Testament, and it's a super clear presentation of the gospel. So look with me in John chapter 3, and we're going to start in verse 1. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him." Jesus answered and said to him, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." You know, if you think about it, from a worldly standpoint, Nicodemus came. He was the best Israel had to offer. He was a Pharisee. He kept all the laws. He was a very righteous man from the outside looking in. That was his passion. That was his goal in life, was to obey the law of God. It says he's a ruler of Israel. He was probably a member of the Sanhedrin. In other words, the ruling class of Israel. It really combined our legislature and our Supreme Court into one body. And so he had tremendous power in the nation. It seems like he came honestly wanting to learn from Jesus, kind of wanting to discover and figure out who he was. It's possible that he came on his own. Maybe he came as a representative of others. But he came wanting to speak rabbi to rabbi. He came kind of one-to-one or appear-to-appear. He wanted to meet Jesus on equal ground. He failed to understand the deity of Christ and who Jesus really was. He came at night. Some says that's because he didn't want others to know he was coming. But some also think that it's a metaphorical reference to the darkness that covered the nation of Israel, the spiritual darkness that Israel had allowed to overtake them. Much like it says in the first chapter of John, where it says, he came to his own, but his own did not receive him. And so Jesus goes on to tell Nicodemus, this very moral man, very religious man, that anybody who comes to him and wants a relationship with God has to be born again. Regardless of his title, regardless of what he's done, he has to be born again. That word again can also be from above. So John may be trying to communicate, you must be born from above or have a spiritual rebirth, so to speak. But what Jesus is talking about is a spiritual transformation out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God. Look at verse 4. Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I say to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit." Now, Nicodemus is not really catching on to what Jesus is talking about, because he sees himself as already in the kingdom. In his mind, by the very fact that he was a Jew, he was in God's kingdom. And the fact that he was a Pharisee and all the things that he was doing to do good and to obey the law of God just put him higher up in the kingdom. So Jesus is really flipping Nicodemus's theology upside down and telling him that even you, Nicodemus, the Pharisee, the Jew of the Jews, has got to be born again and has to have a radical transformation to come into the kingdom of God. So this was a new deal for Nicodemus. He thought he was a shoe-in, and Jesus is saying, unless you come to me, everyone is kept out of the kingdom of God. Nicodemus was counting on what he had done, his own obedience and the fact that he was of the nation of Israel, a descendant of Abraham, to get him into the kingdom. But Jesus tells him it's not about radical obedience, but more about this radical transformation that takes place through the Spirit of God in a person. Water is could be a reference to John's baptism, which the first part of that was repentance, and then John baptized them. It's also a picture of the Spirit, and that Spirit comes from above and transforms each person. Jesus is uses a wind illustration, something that everybody ought to understand, where you can see the results of the wind, but you can't really see the wind. You can see the results of the Spirit of God, but you cannot see the Spirit of God itself. The word for wind and the word for Spirit are the same in the Greek. And this shouldn't have been a new concept to Nicodemus, because the Old Testament talked about this transformation in Ezekiel. Then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idols. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take your heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments and do them. And so even here in Ezekiel, God, through the prophet Ezekiel, is talking about this radical transformation that comes through the Spirit of God as a spirit works through a person. Look at verse 9. Nicodemus answered and said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Are you the teacher of Israel and do not know these things? Most assuredly, I say to you, we speak what we know and testify what we have seen, and you do not receive our witness. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one who has ascended to heaven but he who came down from heaven, that is, the Son of Man who is in heaven." Nicodemus wasn't understanding what was going on. But Jesus couldn't understand how Nicodemus, someone called the teacher of Israel, could not understand this. Nicodemus must have been not your ordinary everyday rabbi, but a well-known scholar, maybe that other rabbis came to for advice or to help them understand. But Nicodemus seems to be completely ignorant of this realm that Jesus is talking about. Jesus, much like the prophets, came to Israel and is talking to them about heavenly things, but being rejected. He says, "You don't accept our witness or our testimony." This word is all over the New Testament, witness and testimony, especially in the Gospel of John. But Nicodemus couldn't understand this basic idea of regeneration through the Spirit. Look at verse 14. "And Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness. Even so, the Son of Man must be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God." Jesus pulls out this Old Testament example to help Nicodemus understand. the bronze snake that Numbers 21 talks about was not magic. It wasn't an idol. The people looked up to the snake in obedience and faith, and God healed them. You remember the story of the Israelites who'd come out of Egypt, and before long they had started grumbling and complaining about their plight. And God sent venomous snakes among them to punish them, to discipline them. And then he had Moses intervened, and he had Moses put up a staff with a bronze snake on the top of it. And if they believed God, that if they looked at that snake and had faith in him, then he would heal them and make the venom non-effective. And so in the same way, we have to put our faith in Christ. We believe him, we obey him, and put our faith in him, and that's where we are saved. Moses made the bronze snake to save the people from one particular thing. Jesus, on the other hand, saves us from all ungodliness. Nicodemus had based his life on what he could do for God. He was the best Israel had to offer, but he still was not good enough. And Jesus wanted him to understand what coming to faith in him could do, not for God, but for Nicodemus. This is how Charles Swindoll sums it up. Trying to achieve salvation through obedience is impossible, and it always leads to hypocrisy and despair. Religion is ultimately nothing more than faith in self, trusting one's ability to be good enough to impress God. Sooner or later, the religionist's deeds will be exposed for what they are, the fruit of pride. Unfortunately, humanity is chronically religious. What could be less complicated than belief? What could be less effortless than faith? There's nothing to achieve, no quest to complete, no challenge to overcome, no method to master, no merit to earn. We only have to trust the one who made us, who loves us, and who satisfied all of God's expectations on behalf of all humanity. Most, however, will opt for religion over regeneration. Pride is not only powerful, it's binding. So we, like Nicodemus, need to come to Christ in faith, in belief, in obedience. And his sacrifice pays for our sin. That's the message that we need to take to the whole world. Hope you'll join me again next week as we continue through the book of John.